If you haven't watched the overview of Valkyrie drops, I heavily recommend watching that video first before this one. It will detail more about what the Valkyrie drop does, as well give a comparison and analysis to alternative methods, such as why should I use a Valkyrie drop over a harasser or a main battle tank or a liberator, such and such. It will explain all of those questions in that first video. So please watch that first if you haven't already. In this video, we're going to be talking about how to set up not only specific loadouts for infantry classes, but also going in depth in how to build your Valkyrie for Valkyrie drops. Before we look at the loadouts, there is a color legend I have created to help you identify and where you should be focusing on specific items or weapons that are heavily recommended for Valkyrie drops. There's a color legend that will detail three colors: green, yellow, and red. Green means low importance, so this would mean basically you can pick any item or any weapon that you really want. There's a small degree that a little bit of a recommendation, but it's totally up to you. It doesn't really affect how Valkyrie drops are in any way, shape, or form. It's just a way just to say you can choose anything you want. Yellow means helpful but not necessary. Now these weapons or items basically mean that if you're doing the Valkyrie drops, these are really helpful, but they're not mandatory. You don't really need them. That you can just live without it, basically. You don't have to worry about it, like having it in your loadout at all. So it's helpful. Like, it's really helpful. Red means heavily recommended. These items or weapons are a must in Valkyrie drops, and usually prioritize in buying it first. So without these weapons or items, you can't really do a Valkyrie drop successfully, determined by whatever class that you're using it with. Here we'll cover the basic infantry loadouts for three specific classes: Light Assault, Engineer, and Heavy Assault. For the Light Assault, you can have any primary that you want. It doesn't really matter. Preferably though, you can just get a fully automatic weapon of your choice with a suppressor. The reason for that being is with a fully automatic weapon, you have a better chance of defending yourself against any opponent. And with a suppressor, it allows you to be undetected while you're still attacking the Sunder or the enemy vehicle. So it's pretty good if you have somebody in your way between you and the vehicle, or someone shooting back at you if they spotted you. So that's why I kind of prefer any primary that's a full auto. Second thing is really important is explosive crossbow. In order to get this, you need to buy the explosive bolt for the crossbow. This will allow you to finish off vehicles such as a Sunder. 2C4 is still not enough to kill a Sunder, no matter what it is, and you need to use an explosive crossbow in order to finish the Sunder. You can put it in fire if you have C4, but with the crossbow you can finish it off. So that's why I heavily recommend it. Another thing that's heavily recommended is drifter jets. Compared to all the other ones, drifter jets allows you to stop your momentum when falling down and even change your direction to wherever you want to go to a certain degree. So say for example, let's say jump jets. It will allow you to go up a little bit, but you won't control your horizontal direction at all. That's the problem with it, and plus it doesn't have a lot of fuel. Icarus's are even worse. It just goes straight up, but no horizontal momentum at all, and it actually doesn't even stop your vertical momentum very easily as well. So I heavily don't prefer those two jump jets at all. That's why I prefer drifter jets, as it will control your horizontal direction allow you to guide yourself. If an enemy vehicle is driving away from you, you can at least follow him to a certain degree. And as well as stopping your vertical drops. So if you want to slow down a little bit, maybe don't want to go in too quick, but just want to go in the right moment, you can do that with drifter jets. Preferably with the levels, level 1 is okay enough. Even myself, even if I Araxium the light assault already, level 1 served me pretty well, although further upgrades are always recommended to go. Of course, with the further upgrades, you can stay in the air longer with more fuel, and that's always a neat little thing to have whenever you're trying to do Valkyrie drops. Another thing is pretty much optional, but it's smoke grenades. Smoke grenades will help you in a way, but it's not necessary. You don't need to buy it if you don't want to. It does help though. It just helps when attacking Sunders, for example. Say if you're just trying to attack a Sunder, throw down the smoke grenade and it will cover your tracks a little bit. That way the enemy knows that something is there, but they don't know where the enemy is. So if they cannot find you, they cannot attack you at all, and they're rather confused, leaving you to fully attack the Sunder without minimal problems at all. So yeah, prefer the smoke grenades in my case, but you don't have to buy it at all. Another thing that you have to buy is C4. C4 is the mainstay of the light assault when doing Valkyrie drops. It's the core thing that you have to buy. At least buy this first before anything else. And also upgrade it as well, because just buying it alone without upgrading it would only leave you one C4. Two C4 is enough to kill main battle tanks and put Sunders in fire. One is still just not enough. So upgrade your C4 and make sure you have it. Lastly is an optional but also helpful thing to have is nanoweave armor. Now say in an instance that you do get spotted while trying to attack a Sunder, having nanoweave armor will allow you to protect yourself, mitigate some of the damage, allowing you to stay alive a little bit longer. So that way you won't get killed as easily, and you can at least try to finish your task before dying. That's why I prefer nanoweave armor. In terms of the levels, try to go for level 4 as the minimum, but the max level is always nice to have, as you can mitigate a lot of unnecessary damage that you just don't really need when doing Valkyrie drops. For the engineer, some of the items and weapons are usually optional, but there is some key important stuff that are pretty good with the engineer that you must buy, and the optional stuff actually helps support the heavily recommended stuff. So starting off with your primary, I definitely recommend going in with the archer. Now this is completely optional, but there's a thing of saying, okay, let's bring archer and destroying the Sunder. Okay, you may be asking, whoa, why bring an archer? It's made for maxes, not for vehicles. Here's the thing though, if you can damage a max, you can damage a vehicle. So if you put that together, you can use the archer to finish off vehicles. So if save a vehicle's on fire, you blow it up and it's actually kind of running away from you, and you need some way to kill it. Can't pull out your AV turret because it's gonna take too long, so pull out your archer and you can at least damage it in a way. So that's why I kind of prefer archer, although it's just a optional weapon to have. You don't have to buy it, but it helps whenever doing Valkyrie drops as an engineer. Second thing is supporting the archer is the emissary. The emissary is a full auto pistol. And of course, like what I said before about the light assault primary, having it with the suppressor will allow you to be undetected in the minimap, so that way you can kill stuff along the way without anybody shooting back at you, at least. So yeah, the archer has a low rate of fire, so definitely full auto pistol help complements the weaknesses of the archer. The last optional thing to have is an AV mana turret. And this weapon is not really actually used a lot in Valkyrie drops due to the fact it just takes way too slow to deploy. You're a stationary target, so that means you can be easily killed. And once you fire it, it just has this big icon in the minimap that you just don't want to have whenever you're trying to do Valkyrie drops. It's more relied on stealth rather than going full explosive, letting the enemy know that you're there. The reason why I still say that you would prefer it, because compared to anti-infantry mana turret or a Spitfire turret, all it really does is just to distract or give you some cover. With a anti-vehicle mana turret, you can at least finish off a vehicle or damage it if it's way too far from you, but it's heavily damaged and you want to finish it off. It leaves some way to allow yourself some options if that happens. So for me myself, I don't use it that much, but it's always nice to have something whenever that comes to the case, when the vehicle is a little bit too far or something along those lines and you still want to kill that vehicle. The rest of the items are basically mandatory stuff that you should always buy with Engineer. The first things first is sticky grenades. Now before I talk about sticky grenades, I'll go for tank mines first, so that way I can explain the reasoning behind sticky grenades for the tank mines. For the tank mines, I heavily recommend that you upgrade it all the way. Upgrading it all the way will allow you to have 3 tank mines, and with the mine carrier will allow you to have 5 tank mines if you put it to mine carrier level 2. Now 5 tank mines is pretty much a lot, but you have to think about it. Tank mines are very explosively useful for vehicles due to the fact they have a lot of damage. You would rather have these than anything else, even in C4 in my opinion, in terms of killing a stationary target such as a Sunder. Now, in order to kill a Sunday, you need to have 3 tank mines. And having 3 tank mines actually takes some time. You need to put down 3 tank mines and of course blow it up with your pistol. But there's a faster way in doing so, and possibly would save you along the way. So why I said about sticker grenades is that it will save you time and it will allow you to get away from the situation, so that way you don't take damage when the target blows up. So of course throwing down 3 tank mines takes some time. Not too long, but it takes some time. There's a faster way in doing this. Throw down 2 tank mines, throw down 1 sticker grenade at the tank mines, then throw a last tank mine at the pile of tank mines that you just placed, then run away. This will save you time, this will save you from damage from the Sunder blowing up in your face, and you don't have to rely on shooting at it, because there is sometimes that when you're close to the enemy Sunder, there's an enemy that will spot you, say, oh, there's an enemy there, I have to shoot back at him. You don't have time to basically defend yourself, and sometimes you do miss because you panic by shooting at the tank mine with your pistol. Instead, bring a sticky grenade and it would just blow up, and it will cause a chain reaction blowing up the Sunder as well. So that's why I prefer the tank mines, the sticky grenades, and the mine carrier. Having 5 tank mines allows you for more options to kill vehicles. So you can kill 1 Sunday and possibly 1 Prowler, or possibly 2 Harassers or 2 Prowlers, or you know what I mean? You have more options to bring more firepower to kill stuff. So you just don't have to go like one at a time and then respawn. So that's a good thing for having Mine Carrier level 2. For the Heavy Assault, any primary works like the Light Assault preferably a full auto with a suppressor, like I said, just to make sure you defend yourself well and not be detected whenever you fight an enemy when you're trying to attack something. Your secondary, same thing. For me, I like the Black Hand, just in case if I need to kill something long range if I need to, or finish someone off due to its power. But you can have any secondary that you feel like in doing. You don't have to put a suppressor, I just put it out there that you can have any secondary that you want. For your rocket launcher, there are two types of rocket launchers. Preferably, they have to be dumbfired, and these are usually the decimator or your faction specific dumbfire rocket launcher. Due to the fact that those rocket launchers deal out the most damage to vehicles, although the decimator, while sacrificing a little bit of ammo, will give you more firepower. And the other end of the spectrum, say for example the S1, a little bit less firepower than the decimator but gives you more ammo. So whatever suits your needs, if you want more ammo or you want more firepower, pick either from those two. Preferably get the decimator because you want to finish off those vehicles as quick and easily as possible, due to the fact that the decimator has more damage than the default rocket launchers. Another thing in terms of your suit slot is an optional nanite mess generator. Now, compared to adrenaline, it's useless. You're not there to kill people, and you're not going to be able to kill a lot of people in a quick amount of time because you're actually going to focus on the vehicle instead, like a Sunder or a Prowler or something along those lines. With resist shield, you're not going to be doing much resisting because you're not in a firefight at all. And if you do take some damage, it's going to whittle away your shield. And if you're not careful enough, it can whittle away your health as well. So I don't really prefer a resist shield. Nanite mess generator allows you to have at least a shield to protect yourself from anything possible, such as enemy shooting back at you or explosion from a Sunder after you killed it. It's a way to protect yourself in a way, and plus it lasts longer from adrenaline. So that's why I prefer it over adrenaline, and that's why it'll keep you alive longer. You can able to finish off your tasks immediately without dying. Although this is pretty much optional, you don't have to upgrade this all the way. Preferably rank 4, 5 is pretty good for a nanite mess generator, but of course, maxed out is always the best way to go. Heavily recommended, but optional. You don't have to upgrade it all the way. The rest of the things are pretty much a mandatory to have is anti-vehicle grenades. Now, before I go into anti-vehicle grenades, I need to say something about grenade bandolier. Grenade bandolier allows you to have 3 extra grenades besides the one that you just got. So say for example, you just bought an anti-vehicle grenade just by itself. Without grenade bandolier, you only get 1 AV grenade. With grenade bandolier, add 3 of that, you have 4 in total. And that's pretty much a really good deal, due to the fact that anti-vehicle grenades, although they do a moderate amount of damage to vehicles, not a high amount of damage, they're still necessary to have in order to kill stuff. Due to the fact that the Sunder has a very tough armor, and it's also a way to take down deployment shield Sunders as well, because heavy assaults can kill deployment shield Sunders much easier than the engineer or a light assault can. And lastly, have C4. C4 is, of course, a way to take down vehicles with ease. And if you have a deployment shield Sunder, you can take out the shields with the C4, then throw all the rest of your AV grenades at the Sunder when the shield is down. Then use your decimator or S1 rocket launcher or any default rocket launcher, and then finish it off. So that's why these 3 classes have a role in anti-vehicle purposes. and they're all tailored for the specifics of Valkyrie drops alone to maximize the potential of killing rather than being flexible in terms of the scenarios and stuff. It maximizes in a way for just killing vehicles instead. With the infantry loadouts explained, I'm going to be talking about the Valkyrie loadout, what you should upgrade and what weapons and what other things you should consider when trying to go for a Valkyrie drop. First thing, let's talk about the weapon. In my opinion, I like to have the Helion. Now you may be thinking, okay, why you should have a Helion? Because a Valkyrie drop is going to be high altitude anyways, you're not going to be attacking from anything below. Here's the thing, you're not going to use the Helion for offensive purposes. You're only going to use the Helion for defensive purposes, such as enemy aircraft trying to shoot back at you or something like that. And how you upgrade your Helion? You should put 1.5 zoom and max out magazine size and ammo capacity, due to the fact that this weapon takes a lot of ammo. It eats up a lot of ammo, so that's why you need to upgrade it, preferably to max rank, as much as possible. And with the Helion, it can damage vehicles, especially Liberators, if you get all your shots onto it. It pretty much is like a Vulcan for the Valkyrie. That's why I like the Helion so much, that other ESFs that I try to dogfight with them, they don't like it when the Helion gets a lot of damage on their ESFs. They usually fly away, or they don't even want to fight you at all. So that's why I prefer the Helion. Now, if you don't have the Helion and if you're going extremely, extremely cheap, you can go for the other end of the spectrum, which is a Wyvern or Wyvern, depending how you pronounce it. The differences between the Helion and the Wyvern: the Helion is more close range, but less accurate over range, and Wyvern, less damage, but more range. So it balances itself out. If you want to have a Wyvern to be more accurate when targeting people, but that less damage, that's up to you. But I prefer the Helion just to put it there so I can scare people away at least, or at least in a way to kill people if I need to. Another thing you should have is squad logistics. Now, squad logistics is basically a way for people to respawn onto your Valkyrie. So think of it as a way like a galaxy or a Sunder. People spawn inside your Sunder, people spawn into your galaxy. Same thing, if you put this little module inside, people will spawn into your Valkyrie. And this is really, really useful to have, because once a person Valkyrie drops and they finish killing a target, there's no way for them to go back up there because you can't pick them up. There's a big battle over there and you just could expose yourself to the enemy. Instead, allow them to respawn and then come back to the Valkyrie that way, instead of endangering yourself on landing every single time when someone kills a person. Another thing you should have is pretty much optional, is evasiveness. The reason why I like evasiveness over hover is I like its speed and maneuverability. Being able to dogfight ESFs is a must with this thing. Although it's not heavily necessary to have, due to the fact that hover has its uses as well. With hover maxed out, you can stay in the air without even touching your controller, but I call that lazy, and plus it's not going to help you in a way to dogfight ESFs or Liberators. So that's why I like to have evasiveness, and plus that extra speed going from wherever point A to point B, it will get to your destination pretty quickly, rather than hover stability instead. Lastly, we're going to be talking about stealth. Stealth is the main important stage of Valkyrie drops. Like I said before in my overview video, if you cannot be spotted, if you cannot be found, if you cannot be seen, you cannot be attacked. there's no way the enemy can attack you, if there's no way that they can find you. That's why you need to have stealth, because most of the time, ESFs or liberators are going to look at their mini-maps and try to find where the targets are. And if they find like a Valkyrie icon, that's an easy target for them to attack. Having stealth removes that icon from the mini-map and allows you to keep Valkyrie dropping as much as possible as long as you don't get actually spotted from a person instead. In the way of upgrading this, level 3 is pretty much good enough for me due to the fact that the range on the stealth is around like 56 meters, around 60 to get auto-spotted in the mini-map. Although, if you think about it, that distance is pretty small in terms of flying. I believe me, like, plenty of mosquitoes or plenty of liberators just passed me by, not even knowing that I was there. Of course, having a maxed out stealth is always gonna make you safer in the long run due to the fact that it just takes you off of the mini-map for sure. In the last part of this series, I will explain why do I pick these certain loadouts with the way I do Valkyrie drops, as well as giving specific combat scenarios. So that way it will explain how it will be done in the infantry perspective, how it will be done as a pilot, how will it be done when you're getting chased by ESF and you need to defend yourself, things in that nature, so that way you're prepared and know what to expect and what are the possibilities that you could do, the loadouts that you built, and the way that you go into the situation in order to be effective in Valkyrie drop combat. I really hope you enjoyed this video, guys, and if you want to stay tuned for more, it's that last video, so stay subscribed for that last Valkyrie drop series video that I will be explaining very soon. This is Nostalgic Days, and I'll see you next time.
Can someone damage this crawler? I have one C4 on me. Oh, I'm gonna snipe.
What's up, guys?
The white crawler. White crawler. I got him.
Can someone bring an ammo sandy from here, Bravo? Please.